Good morning. Welcome to worship. I think that we all deserve a great big round of applause for surviving this past week. I mean, really, come on, guys. Cheer. Yes, we made it. Congratulations. My name is Mikhail, and I get to serve as one of the pastors here. And I'm really, really grateful to be with you all. Today I am here because I personally need people to celebrate with and enjoy the sun with and to be reminded of good news with. So I hope you're here for the same reason. I want to invite you to look at your worship folder through YouVersion. And if it doesn't show up, you can look in your email. I just sent out a link. We've been having some trouble. Some people can find it on YouVersion app, Bible app. Some people cannot. So if it doesn't show up for you, then go to your email and you can follow a link there and you can find it. That will have all of our song lyrics and our responsive reading and announcements and all that stuff. So you'll want to find a way to pull that up. Today is All Saints Day. It's a day around the world where the church remembers and reflects on the great cloud of witnesses that has gone before. And on this All Saints Day, I think it's important for us to remember that we are surrounded, as Hebrews 12 reminds us, by a great cloud of witnesses that has endured much more than power outages, in fact, have lived their entire lives without power, and has endured pandemics and upheaval and all kinds of things. And their witness calls out to us from the ages that the God who they have proclaimed and who we gather to proclaim today is faithful. So I invite you to stand as we sing together about this good God and this good news that we celebrate together.
Well, good morning, friends. We're going to try something a little different this morning. If you guys would just kind of play along with me, I would appreciate that. We're going to kind of sing in parts. I saw that face, Brad. One of my favorite things about worshiping through music is that we are collectively participating in rhythm and melody and harmony. And as Pastor Chris has reminded us, if we can do something as strange and wonderful as that, what else might we be able to do? So I'm going to kind of divide us into sections here, and I'm going to teach each section a little part, and then we're going to sing them all together because they all actually work in unison with one another. Are we okay trying that out today? Wonderful. So this section, if you feel like I'm pointing to you right here, you are part one, and on the worship folder, Bible version app, the lyrics for part one are there for you. Mark and Cheryl and the Smiths and kind of back that way, you guys are part two. And then Levine's in back here, part three. Sound good? So I'm going to teach each section their part, and then we're going to all sing them together. Does it sound good? Wonderful. All right, this first part. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Let's sing that again. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Let's sing one more time. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Part one, feel good with that? All right, part two, here we go. Let us be known. Let us be known, let us be known by the way we love. Let us be known, let us be known by the way we love. One more time. Let us be known, let us be known by the way we love. Part two, you guys feel good? All right, part three, sing love. Love, love, love. The greatest commandment is love. Love, love. The greatest commandment is love. Everyone feel good? Okay, so everyone's going to start out singing part one, And then I'm going to say part one, part two. Then we're going to do part one, part two, part three. And then we're going to put it all together. Sound good? All right. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Let us be known. Let us be known. Let us be known. And by the way we love, let us be known. Let us be known. And by the way, part one and part two. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Part one and part two. Let us be known. Let us be known. And by the way we love, let us be known. Let us be known. And by the way, part three in. Love, love, love. The greatest commandment is love. Love, love. The great, everyone on part one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Part one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Wonderful job, everyone. Thanks for indulging me in that. I appreciate that. Let's sing Be Thou My Vision.
Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart, and I be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence, my life.
Be thou my wisdom.
Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great mother, and I thy true child. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one.
Riches I heed not.
Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now in my heart, high King of heaven, my treasure thou art. Oh God, be my everything, be my delight, be Jesus my glory, my soul satisfied.
Oh God,
oh God, be my everything, be my delight, be Jesus my glory, my soul satisfied.
wash heaven's shores, oh bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, oh ruler of all God. Oh God, be my everything, be my delight, be Jesus my glory, my soul satisfied.
Sing that one more time.
Oh God, be my everything, be my delight, be Jesus my glory, my soul satisfied.
We're gonna spend some time here in prayer over the next few moments. And if I could, I'd like to just sing this prayer with you and over you. So if you would, I just invite you to this posture of prayer. We're going to pray and sing these lyrics, these words that come from St. Francis. So I just invite you to pray along with me these words of Instrument of Peace.
Lord, make me an instrument of peace, an instrument of peace. Lord, make me an instrument of peace, an instrument of peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is darkness, lend me so light. For in the giving we shall receive, and in the dying we're given life.
Lord, make me an instrument.
Lord, make me an instrument of peace, an instrument of peace. Lord, make me an instrument of peace, an instrument of peace. Where there is sorrow, lend me so hope. Where there is doubt, lend me so faith. Where there is injury, your pardon give, your consolation to those in pain. Lord, make me an instrument of peace, an instrument of peace. An instrument of peace, an instrument of peace. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Hi, my name is Amber Hedges, and I'm here today to be in community with you. Please hear and respond to these words today. We gather here to tell the truth. We don't have our lives together, and on our own, we can't get them together. We confess that we are poor, and we are hungry and thirsty for what we cannot provide ourselves. We need God's grace, and we need each other. We gather here to tell the truth, that while we were still sinners, God died in solidarity with us. And now you and I are forgiven, set free, and adopted into a good family. You and I are not alone. We belong to God and to one another. We are God's people, people who are rich and satisfied, a people of peace, reconciliation, and love. So today we gather here to tell the truth. Our lives are better when we are neighbors. We are not all the same, but we are all ready for transformation. We gather here to tell the truth. We will be a spiritual community of hope and transformation that lives the way of Jesus. So we have always had a practice of being good neighbors, but now it seems more important than ever. So right now, for the next 4 minutes, we will practice being good neighbors by having a conversation with one other person. Look around for someone you haven't seen in a long time, someone you don't know well, someone you don't know at all, or just someone you don't recognize in a mask. We definitely want to include our kids in this, so please don't leave them out. In 2 minutes, share your name and a little introduction of yourself, and then answer this question. In 10 years, what will you remember about the ice storm of 2020? Then give your partner 2 minutes to share about themselves and answer the question as well. The music will play for 4 minutes so you know how long you have. And since we also want to be good neighbors by keeping one another safe, here's a few final reminders. We will wear masks to cover our nose and mouth while we talk. We will maintain appropriate distance, and we will not engage in conversation with someone if we are not feeling well. And remember, here's the question you're answering. In 10 years, what will you remember about the ice storm of 2020? Everyone, let's go.
Elsa? Do you want to build a snowman? Come on, let's go and play. I never see you anymore. Come out the door, it's like you've gone away. We used to be best buddies, and now we're not. I wish you would tell me why. Do you want to build a snowman? It doesn't have to be a snowman.
Go away, Anna.
Okay, bye.
And build a snowman or ride our bike around the halls. I think some company's overdue. I've started talking to the pictures on the walls.
Hang in there, Joan.
It gets a little lonely, all these empty rooms, just watching the hours tick by.
Elsa, please, I know you're in there. People are asking where you've been. They say I've courage, and I'm trying to. I'm right out here for you. Just let me in. We only have each other. It's just you and me. What are we gonna do? Do you want to build a snowman?
Thank you for being such good neighbors to one another. I invite you to find your seats again as we prepare to hear a good news story today. Each week when we gather in worship, we make time to hear a good news story, not just each other's small 2-minute stories, but we also want to hear one story each week that points us to the work of God in each other's lives and helps us to listen to one another's perspectives. Today's storyteller was originally scheduled to be with us in April, but you know, it's 2020, so a lot of things have been shifted around. And today we are grateful to have Dr. Jim and Betty Cooper with us. They have served as our Church of the Nazarene district leaders here in Southwest Oklahoma for 10 years and just retired. And so April was kind of the conclusion of their duties, or August, really. And so we wanted to make sure that we had a chance to come to have Dr. Cooper and Betty join us so that we can appreciate their work on our behalf and also hear from them as they move on into their next journey. Now, this is not a goodbye, but this is a transition into a new kind of relationship and a new phase in their lives. And so we've invited Jim to come and share his story with us. Would you welcome Dr. Jim Cooper?
Thank you for that introduction, Pastor McHale, and thanks for the warm greeting. I'll never forget the first time that you greeted me. I don't know if Pastor Chris and Pastor McHale set that up or not, but you were just beyond yourselves and made me feel welcome. So thank you so much. Well, this is a part of my story. It's not all of my story, obviously, but it's sort of the chapter in which I'm reflecting today. Pastor McHale sent me the note that I'm sure she sends all of those who share their story that said, we begin always by saying, hello, my name is, and I'm here because. And I didn't get much further than that, okay? So here I go. Hello, my name is Jim of the House of Betty, and I'm here because, well, because I was invited. But beyond that invitation, I'm here because Jesus found me when I was just 8 years old. In a Nazarene worship service, freckles and red hair, low self-esteem, and the son of poverty. Our home was an 800-square-foot farmhouse with no foundation, no running water, and a little wood stove that heated one end of one room. But my other home was the little country church of the Nazarene. I'm here in part because those people loved me and taught me the Word of God and prayed for me and celebrated my quest to know and to do God's bidding. I'm here because God's grace was extended to me through a denominational church. I know it's not a popular term, a network church, we try and soften it, called the Church of the Nazarene. But it's just a denomination after all. They were then and are still a church with both a local and a global vision. And though I was on a small, obscure farm in the countryside of the Ozarks, they invited me to participate in this dream, a grander vision. They've educated me and given me the love of my life, Betty, invested in my child, cared for my family, loved my grandkids, provided me opportunity to serve Christ, opened my eyes to the needs around me, provided resources to help meet those needs, given me a platform to speak to injustice and advocate for the marginalized, and allowed me to dissent without casting me aside. They have sent me to other countries and invested themselves in me beyond my imagination. I've discovered that through the Church of the Nazarene, I can extend my practice of being a good neighbor, not only influence my community, my city, and those points in between, but also globally I can participate. And like other Nazarenes, I participate in works all around the world in 170 nations of the world. And I'm invited to participate in providing fresh water for families whose children are dying from polluted drinking water. Prenatal clinics to reduce infant mortality. The freeing of those swallowed up in human trafficking, hospitals around the world that treat the ills of the soul, body, and mind. I'm part of educating children at risk throughout the global community in medical clinics and colleges and AIDS treatment programs and disaster relief, refugee ministry and addiction solutions, daily hot meals for thousands of kids, and the richness of multicultural, multiracial community, and a host of other efforts to push back the darkness. And all of this comes to me as a gift from God through a church called the Church of the Nazarene. I'm here because a group of people decided that they could do more together than they could separately. So they struck out to follow Jesus the Nazarene and called themselves Nazarenes in the proclamation of good news to the poor, freedom for the prisoner, recovery of sight to the blind, and bringing freedom to the oppressed. I am here because my Catholic-raised mom encouraged me to stay in the church. When I was a junior in State University, I called home to let my parents know I was leaving the Church of the Nazarene. I had ideas that didn't seem to fit the system, and in youthful idealism was discontented with what I perhaps misperceived, or perceived correctly, as the focus of the church, and so I decided to leave her. I find it ironic that it was my more open-minded mom, raised in the Catholic Church, who encouraged me to wait on a conservative evangelical church and encouraged me not to cast her aside. It was good counsel. It is surprising to me that I'm here in Oklahoma still. There was a gentleman talking to my father-in-law, didn't know he was talking to my relative, when they had announced our arrival from San Jose, California. And he said to my father-in-law, "California? What were they thinking?" After participating primarily as a reformist in the Nazarene family and an advocate for refocus of its mission, I was invited to become a part of the very establishment from which I had separated myself. I find it humorous that I now was the establishment, and a little bit disconcerting. And moreover, I was invited to a very traditional conservative district of about 50 churches with an image of legalism, and maybe the practice, and self-focused institutional religion. But thanks be to God, people of Southwest Oklahoma wanted to change. The district wanted to be innovative and inclusive and engage in their communities and genuinely kingdom-focused. And though there's yet much to be done in regard to reform, God has moved among us, a new vision has been planted in our hearts, and more kingdom-like practices are finding root. And you're a part of that, by the way. It is my sense that this is why you are here. Our journey intersected 5 years ago, whether you knew it or not personally, and you chose to become a part of the Southwest Oklahoma Church of the Nazarene family. I believe you're here for such a time as this. I'm convinced that the focus of this 8th Street Church community of faith will help embed in the DNA of the district some of the newly expressed values of innovation, inclusion, and engagement in your local community. 8th Street's commitment to Kingdom First will enrich the faith expression of your Nazarene district neighbors and will positively influence other Nazarene churches in this area to advocate for marginalized people and be and exhibit kingdom examples of good neighbor practices and be an expression of God's heart. I urge you to engage your Nazarene family then as I leave this office and use your gifting on the Southwest Oklahoma District to promote the values of the kingdom. Be available to participate and build friendships and place 8th Street leaders within the district organization. You, 8th Street Church, can make a lasting and significant difference for the good of many. Well, I'm here to bless you also. Pastor McHale reminded me that you enjoy a good blessing as well as giving one. And so my blessing to you today is based on Exodus 33, Moses' prayer, as he was so distressed in such a critical time in the life of Israel, where God had really decided he was done with them. And he asked of God three things in that chapter. He said, "Oh God, teach us your ways. Oh God, go with us. We need your presence with us. And thirdly, show us your glory." And the big surprise in that chapter, in chapter 34 then, is what God's glory is. So I give you this blessing. If you're comfortable extending your hands to receive it, that's fine symbolically, but at least receive it into your hearts today. A3 Church, may you learn the way of God and the ways of God. May God, the Holy Spirit, convince you of truth and guide you and convict you of the right. May God grant you wisdom to speak and wisdom to be silent. May God's presence abide with you in your families, and in this faith family, may you know the presence. For if God does not go with us, how will we be distinguished from anyone else? And may you show God's glory to others, his glory to rest upon you and be evidenced by your practices, just as God announced his glory to Moses with words like goodness, graciousness, mercy, abounding love, compassion, and forgiving wickedness. May you so be in your relationships, and by such witness, many see you and see God through you and come to faith in Christ. May you, like Esther of the Scriptures, be raised up for such a time as this in your community, on this district, and in the global family. By the power of the indwelling Holy Spirit, may it be so. Amen. Pastor.
Well, as he has spoken a blessing to us, we also want to speak blessing for Jim and Betty. Their leadership on this district has made a way for us. And if you were not with us at the very beginning to hear, because of Jim's leadership, there was money available by selling a property that the district owned to help invest in this building. And that was at the very beginning of our relationship. He and those around him saw a vision for our future before we were even in it. And so we want to say thank you, Jim and Betty, and we have a small gift for you. We know that one of the places that you spent in the world was Brazil, and we are fans of Midtown, Oklahoma City, and so you put those two things together and you come up with Café do Brasil, and so there's a gift card here for you. Would you thank again our friends Dr. Jim and Betty Cooper with me? Any kids who are not already over with Pastor Hope, from fifth grade on down, you're welcome to go over there and receive a story and some playtime together. For everyone else, I want to turn your attention to the Bible app again, where our worship folder provides an opportunity for us to give. There's a link right there to give online, or you can find the text to give number. There's also an envelope at the back table if you want to write a check or leave cash. We take time in every service to do this because this too is an act of worship. It's part of bringing our gifts with us to present before God and to share with one another. And I want to let you know that during this week of ice storms and unpredictability, this building, which is probably our greatest shared resource, has been a gift to many. A gift of warmth, a gift for some of a place to sleep overnight, for others a place to come and recharge, a place to have food and a microwave and warm water. And this is part of what we do together. And this week has felt like one giant symbol of why we give and what we come together to do. So thank you for your participation in that and your continued generosity. There's also a list of things to know, and so I invite you to click on that. If you do not receive our emails or if you have questions for us, if you'd like to receive information from a pastor, you can fill out that contact form, or you can fill out the form to sign up to serve to help set up services for the rest of the month of November. Over here, you'll see two boxes under the stairs. One is designated for cold weather gear, and one is designated for food items. We are collecting both all through the month of November to share with neighbors in need who stop by the church, but also to give extra to the Homeless Alliance and others that are helping to care for our growing population of homeless neighbors during an ongoing pandemic and economic crisis. So if you have extras in your house or if you're going out to buy stuff, please, we would love to see these boxes overflowing with warm weather clothes and shelf-stable and microwavable food items as well. And then finally, last but certainly not least, this Tuesday night, also known as Election Night, is our Jesus is Lord worship service. It's going to be a walk-through worship service, something that we've not done before, but it'll be inside the building, and we've designed it in such a way that you will be distanced all throughout and walk through the building with your family or your germ bubble, and then end up in the sanctuary to receive communion together. We feel like this is a crucial experience of worship for us as a people, particularly in this week. And so we are asking that you RSVP. You'll find a link in your worship folder. We're asking that no more than 25 people show up every half an hour so that we don't have too long of a wait line outside the door. So please make plans to join us for what we think is going to be a really important and meaningful experience for our community and hopefully for others around us as we join in prayer beyond ourselves. So with all that said, would you pray with me now? Holy God, we thank you that you are unchanging, that you are good, and that we can look to the generosity of neighbors, the goodness of people, to see signs of your goodness in the midst of a world that feels increasingly chaotic. We are tired for many, many reasons. We ask that in this time of worship, being in your presence and being with one another, you would give us what we need: energy, perspective, encouragement, comfort, and a vision for the future. We come with open hands and open hearts, and we pray that our ears would also be open to hear what you have to say to us, so that we may leave not just feeling better, but actually filled up with something to offer the world around us. We ask this in the name and the spirit of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Hello. Well, I want to greet you in the strong and the powerful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Chris, and I get to be one of the pastors here. In 1996, I bought these mittens when I was in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and I love them. You should all order them online. They're called the Minnesota Mitt, and they're perfect for days like today. Today is a special day. It is All Saints Day, but for us as a church, it was a day that we were calling Vision Sunday. There are two special Sundays for us at the 8th Street Church. One is State of the Church Sunday that usually happens in May, where we talk about the last year. And then one is Vision Sunday, where we usually do that in August, but of course we couldn't do that. We were planning this to be Vision Sunday, but in light of everything that has gone on and in light of just the burden, I think, that our congregation is feeling as we have been walking through the last number of weeks and the last number of months, and as we walk into a week that feels very unsure for us as a nation, it feels like things are dividing. It's a little bit difficult to talk about what our grand vision is for the church. And so if it would be okay with you, I'd just like to speak to you for a couple minutes from a pastor's heart to the people that he loves more than anybody else in the world. If it would be okay if I would do that, I'd appreciate it. I want to invite you to turn your Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 29, because we're going to let Jeremiah be our spokesperson for today. You know Jeremiah 29:11. It is one of those texts that we call, one of the most misquoted, I should say, texts of the Bible itself. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." That seems like a strange text in light of the weeks that we have been involved with. The months that we've been involved with, and the days that we have to come. It's what I call the Mardell frame verse, you know, where you go and you go to Mardell's and you get this picture and you put it on your house and it makes everything seem just wonderful. But frankly, that is not exactly how this text is framed. And so I'd like Jeremiah, the ancient prophet of the 6th century BC, to speak for us for a few moments. So hear the word of the Lord from Jeremiah chapter 29. It says this: "This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles, and to the priests, the prophets, and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Verse 4, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon: build houses and settle down, plant gardens and eat what they produce, marry and have sons and daughters, find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there, do not decrease. Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says: do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. This is what the Lord says: when 70 years are complete for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my gracious promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future." This is the word of God for the people of God. And let us say together, thanks be to God. This week, I sent a text to somebody and it just simply said, "How you doing?" And the text replied, "I'm doing fine." I said, "Is there anything you need?" The answer was, "No, I'm doing great." A few minutes later, I got a text back. And the text said, "Honestly, I'm not okay." It feels like that is the most honest thing that we can be saying during these days. I'm not okay. This has been a really, really difficult time for me. And if we consider the coronavirus, if we consider these months of not being together, if we consider sickness and those who are in the hospital, if we consider the overwhelming kind of pressure that we're feeling economically and politically, then the appropriate response is to say, you know what? I am not okay. When we look at this text, we look at a group of people who are not okay. In 586, Nebuchadnezzar came in from 700 miles away, and he completely obliterated the people of God. This text that we read is about a group of people whose lives are absolutely destroyed. They call themselves the exiles, and in the exile, everything that was important to them was ruined. Their temple was demolished. Nebuchadnezzar came and he stole their land, their Torah, their law, their sacred scriptures. They were ripped from them, even their ethnic distinctiveness. The things that they did every single day, they were taken from, or it was taken from them. You know, one of the things that that psychologists tell us is that the rhythms and the practices of our lives shape our identity. It tells us what we are and who we are. And these things, Torah, land, temple, these things These were the things that were that told them who they were, and they were taken from them. And now they are gone. And I think about our situation here in recent days. We have lost things that have told us who we are. We have lost things that even help us connect with the God who we read wants to connect with us. We have lost the ability to even interact with one another. Since March 8th, that was the last time we were able to be a community in this building together. Our community, the constellation of the rituals and the rites and the things that are, and the practices, those things that are essential from our for our faith, those have been taken from us. And a sacred time, a sacred way of observing time has even been taken from us. One of the things that we do in times of pressure, in times of stress in our life, is we create sacred space, which allows us to take a step back from the emergencies and the urgencies of our life. But even our sacred space has been compromised, and even our sacred times have been compromised. It's difficult to talk about a great and grand vision when our times and our space and our rhythms and the ability to connect with one another and connect with our God has been compromised. As a culture, we feel enormous pressure even in these days. Everything of the 20th century, those major markers of the 20th century, seem to have all come together. The stressful times of the 20th century have seemed to come all together in the same space and the same time for us now. Currently, we are feeling the same kind of health pressures that they were in regard when the flu pandemic took over in 1918. But not only that, we feel the economic crisis of the 1920s. But not only that, here in this time, we feel the racial unrest of the 1960s. And during this time, at the very same time, we feel the political turmoil of the 1970s. But it's even beyond that, because if you live in Oklahoma City, you might have been 6 or 7 days without any kind of electricity or power. And while Pastor McHale has been up front with us, and we are so grateful for this building, we have had to lend our building out as a hotel and as a safe place for people who are having difficult times, including one of our families whose house burned this week. It's like the cherry on top. All of the pressures of the 20th century have been accumulated into our times right now. And it is not unprecedented for us to go around this great group of people and to say, "How are you doing, really?" And they might, or you might say, "I'm not doing okay." One of the things that we read about in Jeremiah's text is this: that they wanted nothing but their lives back. There were these preachers, these prophets that came and they said, "Hey, you know what's going to be just a few more days. Don't worry, life is going to turn around." And they would listen to them because they wanted their lives back. How do we deal with life like it is now? One of the things that they called for, the exiles called for over and over and over, was this: "God, please make us special again." All of that which shaped their identity, their rhythms and their practices, the things that were sacred to them were taken from them. They were gone. And they just wanted to be special again. It is in this context of loss, that the Lord speaks to the exiles. And I think it is in this context of loss that the Lord speaks to us now here. In fact, one of the things that the Lord says through his prophet Jeremiah is, "Stop listening to the preachers and the prophets that will tell you that it's going to be okay soon." There are two preachers and prophets even currently that speak to us, always promising. Their platform is promising that as soon as we put them in power, that everything will be okay. And the Lord says, no, at least to the people who are exiles, no. You need to find a way to understand that this is now your new life. A difficult thing for Jeremiah to say to the exiles, and frankly, a difficult thing for me to say to us. This is our life. This is the life that we get to have. This is the life as it is now. And one of the things that Jeremiah says as a word from God to these people is, you need to find a new way to live in this life. We want somebody who is going to quickly take away the pain, quickly take away the tragedy. But frankly, that is not an honest story. And one of the things that we remember in Jeremiah and that we are extended to by this God is the gift of honesty. We gather here to tell the truth. We gather here to tell the truth that this is a very difficult time that we're living in. And so if it would be okay, welcome to church, but let's just pause in that for a moment. It is a very difficult time. But one of the things that Jeremiah wants the exiles to know is this, that alienation, being an exile, being in a strange time in a strange land with strange new rhythms, actually can lead to our freedom. This is what Jeremiah wants us to know. And he wants a community to know, his community, and I would want you, echoing the words of Jeremiah, to know that even in this strange land, in this strange time, with these strange rhythms and these strange practices, that it is as possible to live out God's will in this place as it is in any other place. And that is what makes us special. So Jeremiah has a message from God to the exiles, and it is our vision. It is the same message that I would bring to you, and that is this, that you need to build houses. Make yourself at home. This is going to be a little while, so build houses. He also says, why don't you go out and plant gardens? It's going to be a little while, so plant gardens. He says, not only that, but go out and marry off your children. Make a life here. And he says, pray for the city and the prosperity of the city. Because if you pray for the city and it prospers, then you too will prosper. Don't listen to what the false prophets say, but as a community, begin to live in this way. This is the Lord speaking in this context. So here we are. In this space, in this time, with these strange rhythms and these strange practices and things that we've never done before, and we have an urgency and even a desire to go back to the way in which things were. But one of the things that Jeremiah tells us is this. He says that make yourself at home in this place. So I want to let you know that as the 8th Street Church on this Vision Sunday, that is exactly what we are doing. We are going to make ourselves at home in this place. We have said to one another over and over and over that we believe that we've been called to this place, this corner, this space, this facility, this land, this neighborhood, this area. And when I hear Jeremiah say, build houses, plant gardens, marry off your children, pray for the prosperity of the city, I can't help but think about the 8th Street Church. And here's what I mean. When we hear Jeremiah give this command, build houses, one of the things that we're involved with right now is we are involved with paying off this facility. And we do not mind if it becomes a place of worship on the inside or the outside, or it becomes a hotel. We do not mind if it becomes a feeding center or a restaurant. We do not mind if it becomes a place for the rich or the poor. It does not matter. We will provide a safe place in every way we can for those who are our neighbors who are here. So we ask the question, why would we want to pay off a facility like this when we can't even meet in it? It is because we are in a new place in a strange land with strange rhythms and strange practices, and we are going to live into this invitation that Jeremiah, that God by his prophet Jeremiah give to us, and that is build houses. This is a house, a safe place. It is a place where we have become and we can become good and useful neighbors. It is a place where we have been able to create connection and community, and we want to continue to create connection and community. It is an urban building restored, which means that by its very symbol, by its very history, that it is a place by which the very essence of what it means to be restored as a people, it is the image of that hope that we live into together so that we might live the way of Jesus. This is one of the things that we want to do. We want to build houses. The other thing that he says is this: I want you to plant gardens. Make yourself at home here. We've been spending some time talking with our church board about this, and one of the things that we know is one out of every six people here in our area struggles with food insecurity issues. In a conversation that has taken place with our partners at St. Anthony Hospital and even our partners over here at Valor and our friends and neighbors of Sosa Neighborhood, one of the things that we have been dreaming about and praying for and been invited to do is build an urban farm. And so our friends, Pastor Andrea and her husband, Evan, have decided to lead an urban farm, and St. Anthony has decided to lease us this area, not this space, but the area to the east of us. That area over there, that if you would look at it, it's actually bigger than the space that we're in right now, to start an urban farm. And so our vision is to begin a foundation by which we can start an urban farm so that the people who are in need and have food insecurity issues can actually have everything that they need. One of the things that we talk about quite often is, what does salvation look like? And I am coming to believe that salvation means that people don't die. We spend a lot of time speaking about salvation as if it is this thing by which I have a disembodied experience and I get to go to heaven someday after I die. But salvation is more holistic than that. It means that together we as a unified people get to provide ways so that people don't die. And this is the way in which we can serve our neighbors. So over the next few months, you will be hearing stories about starting an urban farm, but you will be invited to start participating in the urban farm that's being built over here on the east side across the street as we establish the 8th Street Foundation. And then the other thing that Jeremiah says to the people is this: marry off your children, which simply means make a future for your kids. So as we start the 8th Street Foundation and we begin the urban farm, one of the things that we want to do is we want to find ways to care for the kids of this neighborhood. First, our own children, and then the children that are around here. This is the image that that Jeremiah gives to us. And it's the image that Jeremiah gives to us. And then he says this: and as you do these things, what I want you to do is I want you to pray for the city. For the last 5 years, we have been finding ways to pray for the city. We have been invited into this place to do the good and useful work of God. And so we want to do this faithfully, whether or not we're on the inside of this building or we're on the outside. This is the kind of work that we have been invited to that makes us special again. These are difficult times. Difficult times for all of us, but it does not mean, again, that the will of God cannot be done. And I believe in these next number of months, just as we've experienced in the last number of months, that it is a community that is bonded together and united under the banner that Jesus is Lord, that will be light in a very dark place in very, very dark times. This is the work that we do. For many, many years, we have said this, that we wanted to be good and useful neighbors, that we were restoring an urban building, not simply because it was just something fancy, because it was more than a building that was being restored. God was actually active. We said that we wanted to create community and connection, and we've said all along that we wanted to live the way of Jesus. We get invited to participate into that right now. 5 years ago, we decided that we wanted to plant a church. And as we look at our next five, our five-year anniversary is coming up in just 3 weeks. And as we look at our next 5 years, I think the call that we have is to settle in this place and do the very good work of God here. We have been saying that we wanted to do that for the last 5 years. And so I think the opportunity is presented to us. In this time of COVID, we have been talking as a church board, and the church board has agreed that we wanted to open our eyes to the opportunities that COVID was providing that we would have never seen before. And these words of Jeremiah, build a house, plant a garden, marry off your children, pray for the city, are words that we allow to ring deep within our hearts and deep within our souls as we try to do this very good and real work of God, and we do it together. So this is what I present to you on Vision Sunday. It's not polished, it's not sharp, because nothing seems to be polished or sharp in these days. But it is an invitation to step into God's future, and so we want to do that, and we want to pray about that together. Would that be okay? So I invite you to pray with me, if you would. Take a posture of prayer. Maybe you want to hold the hand of somebody that you're with as a symbol of unifying our community. And let us pray. So Lord, for the last number of months, we have just been asking, when are our lives going to come back? How do we get our lives back? It feels like we've lost everything, our ability to interact with one another, to be in parish groups, to be in homes, to meet in restaurants and coffee shops. It feels like we have lost our community, and we are in misstep and out of rhythm when we consider the constellation of rituals that have been essential to our faith. It feels like we've been disconnected from one another, and we've been disconnected from you. We feel like we have been disconnected from a rhythm of life and time. We feel like we've been disconnected from the sacred space that you have given to us, and this place that is of safety that allows us to step out of our emergencies and our urgencies, but it just surrounds us because we cannot step into this place. But even then, just as you had an idea for the exiles, you have an idea for us. We do not want to listen to the promises of others, but rather we want to listen to your promise. We do not want to listen to the hot air that comes from politicians and that come from leaders, but rather we want to find that we can listen to your promises and find hope in those promises. My friends here feel enormous pressure. They feel economic pressure. They feel pressure about their health. We feel pressure about the racial unrest that is going on around us and the political turmoil that we feel and that we read about every day. Not only that, we have our own issues. We continue to pray for our family that had their house on fire this week. People who are without power and are cold. We ask that as we move into your future, that just like the exiles, we would sense that you are close to us. And when the time is complete, that you would again prove that you do have a plan for us, plans that will give us hope, plans where our future is set. We do not want to be trite with this verse, but we want to take it as a promise from you to the exiles, and then their story as a promise and a hope for us. This is what we pray for, and we do so in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. So as a symbol of our togetherness, I'd like to invite you to the Lord's table. I understand that there is an election this week, and that it feels like our nation is in great division and turmoil. The imam from the mosque here in town one time asked me, Ahmad and Chauncey asked me, he said, Pastor Chris, how many people do you have in your congregation? And I said, oh, we have about 100 people in our congregation. He said, you, my friend, you have the power to speak
into that 100 people and for that 100 people to be a light to the world in which the world has never seen been seen before. And so from Ahmad and Chauncey to me and then to you, this community actually has the ability to be a light in a very disunifying and dark world. And the reason that that can happen is because we come to the Lord's table. It is at the Lord's table where Jesus himself unifies us. It is at the Lord's table where we hear the story that by his death and his resurrection and his ascension, that he has eradicated evil and he has drawn us into the work of eradicating evil with him. And so I want to invite you to this table. And I want to invite you by way of this, send somebody from your family or your germ bubble, go and take as many of the elements as you need, get a shot of hand sanitizer, germ squirt, and then we will receive the Lord's Supper together. So go ahead and do that right now if you would.
Teach us your ways. Teach us your ways as we learn from one another, learn to love each other. Teach us your ways, teach us to give, teach us to give ourselves for one another, learn to love each other. Teach us to give.
I forgot to say, if you need gluten-free bread, there's gluten-free here on this table, and you can come and receive that bread. I want to invite you to remember this great story, that on the night before Jesus was betrayed by those he came to save, he took the bread and he broke it. And then he gave thanks and said, "This is my body which is broken for you. And whenever you eat of it, I want you to do so in affectionate remembrance of me." And so let us eat this, remembering that we are unified to him and unified to one another. And then in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he held it up and he said, "This cup represents the new covenant that comes in my blood. And whenever you drink of this, I want you to do so in affectionate remembrance of me." Remembering does not just mean recalling. It also means re-reminding one another that we belong to one another. We are remembered to one another. And so let us be remembered to one another as we receive this together. Lord, we're thankful for your prophet and your servant, Jeremiah. May you be as close to us in these days as you were to the exiles in their day. And as we think about what it means to move into this future that is strange, help us to build houses, to plant gardens, to make a way to marry off our children and to invest in our children and to pray for this city, so that as it prospers, we might also prosper. This is what we pray for. In the strong name of Jesus, amen.
So this week we are invited to take on a practice that also comes to us from Jeremiah 29 and from the teaching of Jesus. So in your worship folder, you'll find a practice to pray for their good, and you'll find it on social media and in your email tomorrow as well. So when we pray for the good of the city, for those around us, we take Jesus's invitation and actually pray for those who are competitors or who pose opposition. We pray for those people first. We have an invitation to pray not only for the policymakers that we agree with or the people who vote alongside of us, but also the ones who vote the opposite way, and the policymakers who make decisions that we don't agree with. And we pray also for their good, as we pray for the good of all who surround us. So in this week that is ahead, we invite you to take this practice with you as an intentional opportunity to pray for the good of all who surround you. Would you stand now to receive these words of benediction before we sing our final song together? Friends, may you go from this place and remember often the joy that you are given in Christ Jesus. And may you be reminded all week long that Jesus Christ is Lord, and may you live as if it were so. Amen.
Sing, Teach Us Your Ways.
Teach us your ways. Teach us your ways as we learn from one another, learn to love each other. Teach us your ways.
Sing that again.
Teach us your ways. Teach us your ways as we learn from one another, learn to love each other. And teach us your ways.
Amen. Go in grace and peace.